God, I believe that when your word goes out, it never returns to you empty. I believe that you knew exactly which people would be here, exactly which seat they would be sitting in. You knew exactly who they'd be sitting next to. And I believe it's because you want to draw us towards you. And I believe that there will be people here tonight, God, that you would speak to and move from death to life and move to a place where they'll be standing with you on the last day. And so, Father, I just thank you so much that you will work. And I pray for soft hearts, hearts that are ready to hear what you have to say. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. What if there was something more? What if there was something more? You know, we go through life. Is my microphone doing all right? We go through life looking for something, some person, some place, something that would satisfy us. I don't know whether it's coffee for you. Anyone who does love coffee, who loves the coffee? Right, right. And you know that feeling where it's kind of, you got there and it's kind of giving you a lift, but it's not enough. But maybe it's a place. Maybe it's a person. And we go through life looking for these things. We go through going, if I just get that, then I've got it. And we get them. We all know the feeling that it kind of works for a little while. But after a while, we're kind of left hanging. What if there was something more? What if I told you that there was something that wouldn't do that, that wouldn't disappoint? Put your hand up if you love going on holidays. Come on, I'm going to open my eyes. I'm expecting every hand to be up. There it is, right? We all like going on holidays. Now, I don't know if you've ever had that feeling when, you know, you just can't wait for the holiday and you're counting down the time and you're waiting and you're waiting and you're waiting. You just want to get there, right? And because of the anticipation, you're just building it up. It's like, I can't wait. We're down at 10 days from holidays, 9 days, 8 days, 7.5 days, 7.25 days. You're just kind of putting it all the way and you're waiting and waiting. And that whole point of that whole process of anticipation kind of gets you to the place and you finally get there and you go, yeah, it's all right, I guess. And it's never quite what your mind has conjured up. I mean, I've got 4 kids, right? Let me tell you what that means for holidays. They don't exist, right? What happens is when we say we can't wait, we're going to have a big break and we're going to go on holidays, it means we're going to go away with 4 kids, which and less stuff to kind of do with them, you know, in the house and that kind of stuff. We can't put them in their room and we're kind of just off and we're all stuck in a car and off we go. And it's always never quite there. You know, like this weekend for Easter, we're on the way to Canberra and the kids are like, on the way home from church this morning, you hear them yelling. It's like, it's going to be great. I can't wait to go to Canberra. What's going to be like? And I'm like, I can't stand this. I'm dying already. I need a holiday. And the holiday is with them in the car, right? This is going to be a disaster. You know, there's some places in the world, surely, though, that are just untouched, spoiled, unspoiled beauty that you could just go to and it will never disappoint. Now, some of you may have seen this floating around Facebook. I don't ever click on those kind of viral things very often. I just clicked on one last night, right? So it's so good. Here's a picture of something that you could want to, like, hoop, man. Imagine if you could go and see the Mona Lisa. I mean, just sit there. And these are the kind of pictures you conjure up in your head. You think, you know, like, it's going to be amazing. I could just go and sit there in front, just me and Mona. And we're going to be hanging there, having a good 1 hour of just chill time. Right? Chill time. Right? Here's a picture of what it looks like. There we go. There's you and Mona, right? How's that for a reality that doesn't happen? Now, here's the next one, right? You know, Leaning Tower of Pizza. Pizza. Is it good? Pizza. I've got pizza in my mind. Who's ready for pizza? Leaning Tower of Pizza. Pizza. And you know that perfect shot that everyone wants to get, right? Look at that perfect shot. The guy nailed it, right? There he is, and he's holding the whole tower right there, right? And then you zoom out, and this is what it actually looks like, right? Everyone else is... And it's like, no, it's just everyone's in everyone's photo. But this is my favorite for sure. Because, you know, look, you know what nationality I am, right? I am proudly Chinese, right? And I'm telling you, any Asians in the house tonight? Where are my Asians? Where are they? There, oh, yeah, there we go. Oh, hello, that's great. Wonderful. Ni hao. Good. Okay, so here we are, right? That didn't even sound Chinese. That was just me pretending. So here it is. Great Wall of China. Come on. unspoilt natural beauty. Can you imagine just taking, I mean, that's just, I'm just thinking, I'm going back to my homeland, right? This is me. I'm there and I'm just strolling down the Great Wall of China, and that's what I'm doing, all the way down that wall, right? Beautiful, but this is what it actually looks like. There I am on the Great Wall of China. There it is. Give me a, you know, if there's one thing that Asians can do, right, we can wreck any natural beauty anywhere, right? I mean, you want silence and solitude? Don't go anywhere near Asia. It's just really noisy, dirty, and crazy. And I'd say one thing Asians do well is we do stuff en masse really well, right? There's a lot of us, yeah? There's a lot of us. And so that is what, look at that guy in the middle. Look at that guy, right? That guy's not a happy Chinaman, right? That's not a happy Chinaman. This guy's like, let me go home now. I sick of this, right? He's had enough of this, right? What if there was something, what if there was some place that just didn't disappoint? Let's go further. What if there was a place, and I'm going to tell you about that place tonight, and you probably know where I'm going with this, but what if there was a place that no matter how great a sermon I preach tonight, I don't know if it's going to be any good, whatever I do, I might preach the best I've ever preached. I could be off the charts. I could basically be floating, right? But I tell you what, whatever I say, and I like selling stuff, right? Like I'm good at it. I like to just convince people to do things. You know what? Whatever I say, it's going to fall short. Because whatever I do tonight, I'm going to undersell. Because we're going to be talking about what eternity looks like. What it looks like to be with God forever. And what would it look like? What would it mean? What would it feel like to have this place that will forever satisfy? And will not only under-deliver or not even meet your expectations, will always over-deliver. We go through life trying to chase that something, that some person, that some place that will satisfy. C.S. Lewis, one of the most quotable guys in history, right, says this. If we find ourselves with a desire that nothing in this world can satisfy, that's all of us, the most probable explanation is that we were made for another world. The fact that our heart yearns for something earth can't supply is proof that heaven must be our home. That's a big quote, isn't it? Isn't that off the chart? He's saying you can go through life and you can wait and you can hope and keep trying to find things, but you'll constantly be dissatisfied. And that in itself is tapping into the fact that deep in our DNA, we aren't meant for this world. We are meant for something bigger and something more. And as I said tonight, I can't oversell it. And I want you right now to imagine the best picture you can possibly picture of heaven. I'm letting you put anything in that picture. Go, whatever it is. You ready? You got it? No, I really mean it, right? I mean, you want unlimited pizza? What do you want? You put everything in your head right now for heaven. Better than that. Times 10,000 to the power of infinity, if that's even possible. That's right. Here's the deal. That's how good it is. And tonight, I'm going to have a go. A weak, half-hearted go. I'll give my best shot at just peering, pulling back the curtain a little bit, and you'll get a little glimpse. And I'm hoping and convinced that tonight there'll be people who realize I'm actually not going to be there, and I want to be there. So I'm going to show you and tell you what it's going to look like. I'm going to do four things about what heaven looks like according to the passage that we just heard read. First point is this, and I'll do this one very quick. Heaven is a new heaven and earth. Heaven is a new heaven and a new earth. Read this. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I'm not sure what your picture of heaven is or was or how it is, and I know Dave Jensen spoke last week? Dave Jensen spoke last week. If it was the same sermon that I heard, he talked a little bit about that heaven is not off sitting on a cloud. Was that you last week, right? Now, I don't know. I was sitting in the morning congregation when Dave was talking about people singing on clouds with like harps and stuff like that and kind of sitting there, and you know, I just sort of had this picture of Dave Jensen, right, with his massive tattoo sitting there in a loincloth playing a harp, and I just thought, I don't want to be anywhere near that cloud, right, quite frankly, right? I mean, can anyone pick, you know, give a cheer if you think you want to, no, don't do a cheer, right? Dave Jensen up there, right, no problem. That is not what heaven looks like. That's called disturbing, that's what that is, right? But let me tell you what it looks like. It's a new heaven and a new earth. The creator, the original designer of heaven and earth, he comes and he renews and he renovates and he restores what he wanted to make, what he did originally make. And he renews it and he renews all of creation into a new heaven and a new earth, and all its current brokenness is passed away. In fact, to the point where there's no sea, and you might think, why is there no sea? That's just ridiculous. I mean, I like a good bit of splashing in the, you know, what, I mean, all you surfers out there are like, oh, we just ruined. I don't want to go to heaven anymore, right? What's the go? No, the deal is this. It's representative of something. Sea represents trouble in the Bible. It represents troubled waters. It represents death. And all that is passed away. So the first point here is this: heaven is a new heaven and a new earth. That is this: you don't need to settle for the old. You don't need to settle for what creation is like at this point, this broken world. All of us know it's broken, don't we? Come on, I mean, you don't need to, if you don't think it's broken, you've been asleep. You just turn on the news and you already know within seconds it's broken. You think about what's going on in your head, your heart, you know it's broken. The great news is you don't need to settle for that. And let me tell you how good it will look. Oh, let me tell you how good it will look. It is going to be this. Now, you may think, look, if you want to sell this to me, why are you calling it like this? Here we go, ready? Heaven is a wedding. Now, I don't know how you feel about weddings. Now, let's get some truth going on. I want some truth time. Of course, we all like a wedding-ish, right? You know, weddings can be great and they can be fun. Now, I want you to put your hand up right now if you are willing to be honest and say, I mean, some people do like weddings. I mean, but you, I don't know, could anyone go to a wedding every week and just say, I love weddings, right? Here's the deal, right? Put your hand up if you feel like weddings, after a while, start to feel long and tiring and generally all pretty similar. Keep your hand up. Right, good. Now, if you look around, if you're married, if any of these people are at your wedding, you've got stuff to sort out with them, right? No. All right, you go sort it out. No, joking. Here's the deal. What is it like? A wedding? And you might think, Steve, come on. I mean, like a long, tiring wedding. I don't want to be part of a wedding. Now, let's do this instead. Who's willing to say, okay, girls. You know, the truth is, a lot of girls, you think about, my daughter's thinking about a wedding right now. She's four, right? Now, girls, who's looking forward to, if God so wills it, you know, one day, having the most spectacular and just beautiful wedding, you're in a white dress and you're about to marry the perfect guy that God has planned for you. Who's looking at it? Girls, come on. Any girls? Come on. Willing? Come on. The girls are like, oh, don't make me do this. Come on. Okay. Men, be a bit braver. Okay. Men in the house who aren't married, right? Who right now is looking forward to, you know, their wedding day and being married? Come on, let's go. Come on. Men. There they all are. There we go. You guys all should talk to each other, by the way. No. Now, here's the deal. Right now, we kind of think, look, that'd be a really good thing to do. But, you know, I want you to imagine this. What is the most beautiful thing about a wedding? I tell you, one of the most beautiful things is this. I tell you, if you're getting married, guys, the guys who put their hand up, I can tell you something is going to happen to you if God so wills to give you a lovely wife and a beautiful wedding. There's going to be a moment, can you imagine it, guys? You're there and you're excited. This is the day. And you're there at the front of the church and you're kind of nervous. It's all about to happen. And you know what's coming. The doors are about to open. And you know that moment's coming. And the doors open and you're already picturing, is she going to look, what's she going to look like? I haven't seen the dress. And I want you to imagine this moment. And you're there, guys, and you're waiting. And guys who are married, you remember this feeling. And I want to know how you feel, right? The doors open and out she comes in her track pants. And she's there, right, in the trackies and some thongs and a singlet holding a VB, right? And she walks out, she goes, hey, mate, let's do this, you know? And she walks down the aisle, we're like, let's get married. And right now, you're in your suit and just going, this can't be happening. This is the stuff of nightmares, right? This is the stuff of nightmares. You know, nobody does that, because I tell you what, I mean, I hope, not even in the western suburbs, right? There we go. Come on. Am I allowed to say that? I mean, I don't know what a Rooty Hill wedding is like, but Ugg boots might feature, but we'll see how we go. Here's the deal. The deal is this. It doesn't happen because I'll tell you what a bride looks like. She steals the show. She is stunning. I'm going to do something that I've never done in public before. I'm going to show you 2 minutes of the day that I saw the most beautiful thing I've ever seen. Now, the reason why I haven't shown it in public is this. Just before the wedding day, on the wedding day, my brother was kind of giving me a bit of a, right? He was my best man. And he said, "You're going to cry." I said, "You know, there are moments where you can cry in private, right? Maybe a few of your really close people might be happy to see you cry. But I'll tell you what you don't show, right? You don't show every single person you've ever known, and you don't start bawling like a blubbering mess, right?" And let's just say, I'm going to show you 2 minutes of the most beautiful thing I've ever seen. And why don't you watch this, and we'll cut it before the kiss. All right, let's go.
Cut, abort, abort, no. Look at these guys, not cutting. Cut, cut, abort, abort, no.
Oh, there we go. Now, give us a cheer if you think my wife was thoroughly gorgeous that day. Come on, there it is. There it is. And I had so many of my blokes, my friends who were at Moore College at the time, if you watch, they're all laughing in the background. Oh, look at John, he's crying. You know, I'm thinking, how immature. And then during the video, Dave Jensen, they're going, right. People like him. Now, here's the deal. You know why I cried? It was honestly the most beautiful thing I've ever seen. And there she was in white. And when she came out of that door, I just thought, this is like nothing I have ever seen. And on the last day, it's called a wedding. And it'll be like nothing you have ever seen. John says that the bride is beautifully dressed, adorned. The word in the original Greek is kosmeo, the word from which we get the word. Wow, mate, Galeas, right there. Greek is still sharp, man. Look at that. Look at that. Cosmetic. Right? Cosmetic. That is the whole word that's used at times about putting, making somebody beautiful, putting the beauty on. And it's nuts. And this is the words are perfect there because John says, on that day, it's going to be stunning. But who's going to be stunning? This is the interesting thing. This is the weird thing. You think, man, we're talking about Jesus here for sure. Right? Stunning. He's amazing. And you know what we're doing? It's not because Jesus is the groom. And so we're thinking, who is stunning? Who is actually beautiful? Who's kosmeo? Who is that? Do you know who it is? It's the church. And you think, what? You think the church? What? That means that's us. I mean, look, I mean, you're not bad looking, but I mean, that's us. And you're going to think, how does that work? You know, the deal is this. The church right now, it's the whole group of people who are followers of Jesus. And what God is doing is, why it's going to be so stunning, is right now we look at the church and we see a mess. And we see brokenness. But what Jesus is doing is, he is working in amongst us and he's working towards that last day when they are going to be perfect because there's going to be no more sin. And all that struggle we have with sin and brokenness is going to be done away. And it's going to be amazing. And there's going to be a massive banquet that day. And I'm talking about a banquet, like a big wedding banquet. Jesus talks about it being like that. Do you know how amazing that's going to be? It's going to be stunning. Do you know how much, I mean, like, I don't know what you like, what you picture when it comes to a wedding banquet. No, we're not talking like a, you know, you with the Westerners here, you know, you do like a three-course meal. I mean, I tell you, you haven't seen a banquet, you've seen a Chinese banquet, right? You've been to a Chinese wedding before, right? You don't do three courses, you don't even do four, you don't do six, you don't do seven, you do 10 courses at a Chinese banquet, right? So much so, there's so much food left over and all the Asians there, they bring out little takeaway containers. No, put it on the, no, we don't do that. But here's the deal. It's going to be stunning. It's going to be overabundant. It's going to be amazing. And it's a party to end all parties. And this is a day that you want to be in on. This is a day that will end all parties. Thirdly, heaven is a city. Have a look at this. And then I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God. Out of heaven from God. If you could live in any city in the world, where would you live right now? Come and say it. And I looked at Ray Galea because I remember, I don't know how many years ago he said this to me when I once had a chat with him after a conference. And I said to him, mate, you're going to be, you love being the pastor at NBM? You want to know his answer? He said, yes. And I said, how long are you going to be there? He goes, I'm going to be there for life. He said, unless someone calls me and tells me to move to New York, then I'm gone. Right? So if you work in the church office and someone calls from New York, hang up the phone, right? Because don't let him take it, because he's going to run, right? And I'm just picturing Ray Galera in New York. I mean, like, you know, like, there's Scott who leads the music, right? I can see him in New York, right? The guy's got his leather satchel and he's walking around and, you know, it's like he's total hipster, right? Dave Jensen may be in New York, you know, maybe he's a bouncer outside the pub. Now, we'll see how, you know, Ray Galera, I'll tell you where Ray Galera. Ray Galera is driving a taxi for sure, right? There he is. Ray Galera, the Maltese taxi driver, is going to be making you laugh all the way, right? Down First Avenue. You know, there's the thing. Any city in the world, the truth is this. Why are cities attractive? And why is heaven represented here as a city? It's not actually a literal walled city, right? It's a city because it's a permanent place of residence. It's a place where Jesus says, my Father has many rooms. He sets up rooms for people to come and live in. A great number of people who are there. A great number of people who have followed Jesus like you expect in cities. But here's the key. What's the key about this city? It doesn't matter that there's so many people there. It doesn't matter that there's many rooms. You know what it's going to be? I tell you what, it's going to be so good. The key to this city is who lives there. And the key is that, rip those verses up again for me, the key is this, and I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people and he will dwell with them. They will be his people and God himself will be with them and be their God. I'll tell you what it looks like to live in this city. It means living where God is at. It means being connected. It means being as close as possible to him. Do you know what something, if you guys are someone who love the Bible and love kind of seeing these kind of interesting things that happen in the Old Testament and the New Testament, let me tell you a little bit about this. Do you know what the shape is in Revelation 21, 22, the shape of this city? Anyone know that in Revelation? All right, let me read it to you. Ready? Revelation, in this chapter, it says this in Revelation 21, verse 16. Come on, get your, what's the word when you talk about shapes? Geometry. Get your geometry on. Ready? The city was laid out like a square. Listen to this. As long as it was wide. He measured the city with a rod and he found it to be 12,000 stadia, whatever that is, in length and as wide and as high as it is long. On the count of three, everyone tell me what shape it is. One, two, three. It is a what? Look, everyone's like, right? It's a cube. It's as long as wide as high as each other. And so you kind of think, good on you, Steve. You're trying to tell me that this is exciting. There's a big cube coming out of the sky right now, right? Why do I want to be involved in this cube? What's the cube about? I'll tell you what this is going about. Do you know in Solomon's temple, and the temple plans that have been to build for the place of worship of God. You know, there's a whole, all these outer courts, and you can't get into the inner court. That inner court is called the what? The Holy of Holies. You cannot go in there. The priest gets to go in there once a year. And inside the Holy of Holies, there's only one thing. It's the Ark of the Covenant. Do you know what's in the Ark of the Covenant? The Ark of the Covenant, the place where the Ark of the Covenant is God's place where he dwells. That's why you can't go in there. And what are the dimensions of the Holy of Holies? Anyone know? You go and look it up in 1 Kings later. 1 Kings chapter 6. It's a cube. It's built exactly like a cube. And the whole point is this. You're meant to go, wow. Are you serious? We are living in the cube. And you got to think, I can't just believe the preacher just said we're living in the cube. But do you hear what I'm saying? We are living. The Holy of Holies is the city. The place where you can't even go near. It's the place that no one's been able to go near. This is the place where we live. We live totally with God's presence. Do you want to be with God? Do you want direct access? Do you want me to tell you how much direct access you have? This is how close you get. You will be able to see his face. What would it be like to look into God's face? If you looked up into God's eyes and you could actually see him, what would you see? You know, I've got four kids, and you know one of the moments that I feel most fatherly? One of the moments that I feel most fatherly, no, it's not dropping the kids off to school or doing all those. I mean, those things are all part of, you know, I was going to say cleaning, like my wife does that, eating, cooking, and my wife does, no, we better stop. All right, here's the deal. What is the thing when the times I feel most fatherly? It's when one of my kids falls down or hurts himself or is sad and the tears start rolling down. And what do? Straight away, I'll sit there and their tears rolling down and I'll be on here and I grab them and they sit on my lap. And they sit on my lap and the first thing you do is you wipe away their tears. And they look up at you through these, must be looking at you through blurry vision with all their tears, and you wipe away their tears and you say, it's going to be okay. It's going to be okay. And you know what we find out? Is this, the last point is this, heaven is a place of no tears. And at that point, this is the bit that I believe is where the rubber hits the road. All that feeling you have felt of brokenness, of suffering, listen to this, he will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things have passed away. Friends, when was the last time you cried? Come on, I've been public. I've shown my jolly wedding video, right? When was the last time you cried? When was the last time you really wept? Or when was the last time you cried so much on the inside? When was the last time you mourned, you were in pain? When was the last time you were so aware of your brokenness and the brokenness of the world? Guess what? Please look at me. Guess what is happening? A day is coming for those of us who put our trust in Jesus, where God himself, I'm allowed to be a little bit excited at this point, surely, where God himself will come and you'll look up at him with those blurry eyes and he will wipe away every tear and he will say, enough of that brokenness, enough of that pain, enough of that death. And that time will be an incredible time. And there'll be no more cancer. There'll be no more children dying. There'll be no more wars. There'll be no more children in detention. And all these kind of things that really get us wound up. Why won't there be? Because there'll be no fear. Why would there be no fear? Because there'll be no war for this. Why would there be no war? Because there'll be no sin. And that's what's going to happen. And that is what's coming to us. And today, I want to say this. Right now, here's the pivotal point of the sermon. If you've been sleeping so far, this is when you want to wake up. I'll tell you why. It comes down simply to this line. Do you believe it? Do you believe that this is going to happen? How sure are you? And I want to tell you today that if today this is a nice fairy tale, and you've walked in, you've missed what God wants to say to you today. God says to you today, that these words are trustworthy and true. How sure are you that Jesus is coming back? Because I can tell you without a shadow of a doubt, he's coming. And I can tell you beyond a shadow of a doubt, you want to be there. As I close, I want to tell another story. We've talked about a wedding, which is the happiest day. And I want to talk about a day that is probably the saddest day that Naomi and I have experienced. Definitely that Naomi has experienced. It's the day that I saw Naomi cry in a way that I've never seen her cry before. Okay? When I started dating Naomi, more than whatever, 12 years ago or something, or 13 years ago, I met her mum. Mum's a beautiful, lovely person. And she was only 55 at the time when she got diagnosed with a disease that you associate with 80-year-olds or more. She got diagnosed with Alzheimer's. And she got it at 55, which means that at 55, she was in a place where she was beginning what they called the slow death. And I would watch these stages. I never really knew her totally healthy, but I would watch grief happen slowly over 10 years, just constantly losing a memory from the bits where you kind of misplaced the washing all the way through to those horrendous moments when Naomi might come up to her and she'll be saying, "Who are you?" Can you imagine that happening? And nothing really prepared me for the day that when she was at 65 years old, Naomi's mum died. and she was so young, and it was so wrong. And I saw a brokenness in the world that day, and tears that came from Naomi that I've never seen before. On the day of the funeral, here's a picture of when Naomi came into the church at the start. And I won't ever be able to forget the feeling of, what do you think about when you hold your wife as she says goodbye to her mother? And as we picked up our three children at the time, all of them are holding these letters that each of them wrote to Grandma. That was a bad moment, but I think nothing for me prepared us for the fact that I think when we went to the burial site, and that's when Naomi really wept, because she saw death, and as the dirt goes over and you throw the flowers in, that's the time that I saw brokenness. So this was a horrendous time, because what happened was, at this point, Naomi put the flowers in, and you look at Reuben, who's our eldest, and something happened to him. He just uncontrollably started bawling and crying. And it was just the fact that this is so in front of him. Grandma was going into the earth. I'm going to do something that I haven't also done before, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to read out to you the card that Reuben made for Grandma, and I'm going to use that as a lesson to close. So here's the next photo. This is Reuben with his card, and he took the card and he told me what he wanted to write, so I just wrote it all down, what he said, and he put the card into the coffin, and it simply says this: Dear Grandma, you are getting buried now, but it's just like you are sleeping. I've made you a letter in the shape of a parrot out of different memories I have of you. But you won't see it, because it will turn into dust. And so will you. I will also throw in some flowers. But I'm going to see you when Jesus comes back. So I will see you again. Goodbye, Grandma. I'll be seeing you really soon. Love, Reuben. You know what line I love in that boy's little letter? I love the rawness, I like the honesty. But you know one line I really love? I love the fact of how confidently he just says, I'll see you really soon, because Jesus is coming back. And I reckon something happens as you grow older. And we kind of forget just how certain that is. And for him, that's just like fact. It's just like, here's the deal, Grandma, you've died, but that's okay. I feel sad, but that's okay, because Jesus is coming back and I'm going to see you soon. And here's the deal. Tonight, none of us can pretend that this isn't true. How many of us tonight are going to actually take the step and realize, you know what? Jesus is coming back. That's just a reality. That's a certainty. And I want to know, are you going to be there that day to see God's face? I'll tell you what, it's going to be great to see Naomi's mum's face. I'm going to run up and I'm going to give her a big hug. But it's going to be nothing like seeing God's face. And maybe there will be just one tear. Maybe. It might be on the face of Jesus. There won't be a tear of sorrow. It'll be a tear of joy on his wedding day, as he meets the people who've given their lives to him, and he brings them into an eternity with him. The same face that once wept over Jerusalem and its brokenness. The same one who on the cross stayed there taking the penalty for our sin, the same one who God turned his face away, now raised to life, now he's making everything new, and it's the same one who answers this question. He says, if you're thirsty, come to me. Have a look at this. The two questions that I've got are this. Are you sure? Because it says he will sit on the throne and says, I am making everything new. Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. Next question. Are you coming? To the thirsty I will give water without cost, from the spring of the water of life. And let the one who is thirsty come. Let the one who desires to take the water of life without price come. Would you come to Jesus tonight? You know what it looks like? It looks like responding to the great banquet. It looks like saying tonight and praying to him and saying, I want to be there. I want to give my life to him. It means saying, I want to get ready for the day when all that brokenness and all the pain, all the heartache and all those tears are washed away. That is coming. And I want to see as many of you there as possible.